Good morning and welcome. Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. One more time, good morning. Welcome to all of our alumni. We're so happy that you're here. And if you're a student here, we welcome you. And if you're just forever family, we welcome you as well. Let's go ahead and stand to sing our first song. And after we sing our song, we can be seated. We just want to praise the Lord together.
Hello, good morning, and happy Sabbath. How are you today? Good morning. So great to be with you. If you don't know me, my name is Pastor Anthony Leiter. I get to serve here as pastor for young adult ministry here at Keene Church. And we just want to welcome you to Elevate. We're so glad you're here. Now, we recognize there may be a few guests here this morning. So if you don't know, Elevate is a young adult contemporary worship service here at the Keene Church where we believe there's always room for one more. So that means no matter who you are, where you're from, where you come from, what your background looks like, what your past looks like, man, you're welcome here. We're so glad you're here. Welcome home. I'd like to introduce you to someone, my friend, colleague, President Anna Patterson.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Welcome, Keene Church family, to Elevate. On behalf of Southwestern Adventist University, we are so glad that you are here for a weekend full of events. And for those of you that are visiting, we really, really are thankful that you've decided to join us this morning.
Now, here's a question for you, President Patterson. What is one maybe fun trivia alumni weekend fact that you can share with us? I know it's a little vague.
Only one.
Well, you can share more than maybe one or two, maybe one.
Well, one fact that I think is really interesting, you'll notice the ribbons here on my name tag, is that when I was elected president of Southwestern Adventist University, one thing that I'm really proud of is that I'm the first alum to serve in this role as president of our university.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, we can clap for that.
And this ribbon, I don't know, my eyes are not that good, so you can read the number off of it.
It does say 25. But I never would have guessed, you know, a year over 24, so. Love it.
Well, anyways, we're so thankful that you're here. It's a privilege. The years that I spent here as a professor as well, just ran into some of our former students that now have families of their own, and it's just the most rewarding thing to see generations continue.
That's beautiful, beautiful. Wow. Well, no matter if you're a regular with us today or you're visiting for the weekend, we're so glad you're here, and we just pray you enjoy worship this morning.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
I ask that you bow your heads in prayer with me today so that we invite God to join us here. Dear Heavenly Father, I am so glad they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. We gather here as alumni, friends, and family, but more importantly, brothers and sisters in Christ. And that's because you have called us your sons and daughters. So, Father, we ask that you meet us here today. Inhabit the praise of your people. Speak to our hearts through the message. May what we feel and experience here today, may we take it with us when we leave these walls, Lord. And may we show your light to a dying world that so desperately needs to hear the message. And if there is anyone here that has not accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior, we ask that today be the day they hear his voice. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
The name above all names, you are worthy of all praise, and my heart will sing how great is our God. I love you, Lord. Oh, mercy never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will see of the goodness of God. darkness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, surrender now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, it trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great. Great is our God.
H to H.
And H to H he stands.
Time is in his hands.
And time is in his hands. Beginning and the end. Beginning and the end. The God that three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great. How great is our God.
name above all names. You're the name above all names. You are worthy of all praise. And my heart will sing how great.
Tell you every time I come here, it's such a blessing to hear everybody sing, and it's just awesome. My name is Chris Rhodes, and I get the privilege of serving as the Alumni Association President.
Hello, everyone. My name is Austin Powell, and I'm the Interim Vice President for Advancement here at Southwestern.
And as you know, this weekend's Alumni Weekend, we get to celebrate the 130th anniversary of this school. And we want to just take a second to see, is there any students or former students in the congregation today? Please stand or raise your hand. That's two. Wow. Awesome. Good to see you. Students in the normal section. Awesome. Austin, we're also up here to tell them a little bit about a really cool project that's happening on campus.
Absolutely. There's some exciting things happening at Southwestern. And you might not know this, but this year we are celebrating the 30-year anniversary of our library. And ironically enough, I'm celebrating my 30-year birthday this year. And you know, people told me when she hit 30, your back's not gonna do what it used to, and it's kinda happening. But you know, it's the same for our library. After 30 years, the joints just don't do what they used to. So for our fundraiser, for our project this Alumni Weekend, we want to pour into our library to continue the legacy of academic excellence. But not only that, on the top floor, we will be developing a student success center. Now, this will house our Office of Student Success, which does services like advising, career services, and mentoring. And I get this all the times when I share with alums just like myself. When they hear about the amazing things happening, they say, wow, I wish this was here when I was here. So by giving today, we're going to be helping the legacy continue.
That is so cool. And I got to say, personally, the library holds a special place in my heart because I was not the most phenomenal student. I did take college algebra 3 times. And each of those 3 times, I spent a tremendous amount of time in the library eating pizza from Royal Pizzas, if anybody remembers that. But I love to see this project because the place truly, honestly, I did spend many, many hours in the library, and that was my sacred study area. And it means so much to me to see that not only is the library going to be somewhere for current students to do well in their classes, but it will also provide a place to help further a career and introduce them into the workplace. So, Austin, did you tell them about how they can donate, or what's the monetary amount we're trying to raise this weekend?
Yes, absolutely. So we're trying to raise $2 million. We already have $600,000 raised, but this weekend, in honor of 130 years, we're looking to raise $130,000. So by giving on the QR code there, you can follow to Adventist Giving, look for the options where it says Swallow Alumni, and if you give during this weekend, we are honoring and dedicating the tower of our library to the Alumni Tower, where your name will be on the staircase as it goes up. Additionally, if you don't like QR codes, you can also text. If you text 41444 and text Learning Center, it'll prompt you to give. Thank you all so much for your commitment to Adventist education and for the difference you're making in our students' lives.
And I will say, $2 million is made up of $2 million $1 bills. So any amount helps.
Absolutely.
Thank you. I wish you all a happy weekend. Thank you for coming.
Hey, as we continue in worship, would you bow your heads with me as we pray together? Heavenly Father, God, we're so grateful to be here today. We're so grateful to be worshiping you. God, thank you for the gift of the Sabbath, first of all, today, God. The chance to rest, the chance to, perhaps at the end of a long week, step into a different frame of reality and remember, God, that you have taken care of us. God, you've given us everything that we have, everything that we need. And so we just say a prayer of thanksgiving today. God, we also say a prayer of thanksgiving for the fact that we're celebrating alumni this weekend, those who have come and gotten education here at Southwestern. God, we're so grateful for each one. And we just pray that you would walk with each one, those who are current students and those who are former students, that you would extend a blessing, your love, and your peace to them. We pray, finally, God, that you would walk with us throughout the rest of the service, that you'd be with Pastor Randy as he delivers the message with us, and that you would speak, that we would have ears to hear. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Hello, good morning. I hope each and every one of you is enjoying this Sabbath that God has blessed us with. My name is Gabriel Castillo, business alum of class 2017. It's crazy to already say that, right? 2017. That's incredible. I want to invite each and every one of you to open your Bible or your Bible apps to 1 Kings 19:13 to 15. I want to hear a strong amen once you guys have it.
Amen.
1 Kings 19:13 to 15. Amen. Let's read. When Elijah heard it, he pulled his cloak over his face and went out and stood at the mouth of the cave. Then a voice said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He responded, "I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, and put your prophets to death with the sword. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too." Verse 15, the Lord said to him, "Go back the way you came, and go to the desert of Damascus. When you get there, anoint Hazael king over Aram." Thank you.
Amen. Happy Sabbath, everyone. My name is Mickey Johnson. I'm the class of 1978. It's not an honor year for me, so I'm just introducing our famous speaker this morning, Randy Roberts, Dr. Randy Roberts. Randy Roberts was born in South America to missionary parents and remained in Latin America until after college. Until college. He graduated from Southwestern Adventist University in the class of 1981. And for over 5 years, he was pastoring in the Texas Conference. During that time, he completed a Master of Divinity, and then he went on to Loma Linda. He was the chaplain of Loma Linda, and he worked on his master's degree in marriage and family therapy. Then he became a teacher of religion at Loma Linda University. He did that until 2000, the year 2000, and in the year 2000, he became the senior pastor of the Loma Linda University Church of Seventh-day Adventist. Now, Randy has spoken to many and various audiences, both nationally and internationally. But we want to get a little more personal. Randy is married to Anita Justiano Roberts, also a graduate from Southwestern Adventist University. She also works She works for the Southeastern California Conference of SEA in clergy spouse care. And not only that, but she also serves part-time as a pastor in the senior ministry of Loma Linda University. He has two children, Randy and his wife Anita. Randy and Anita have a son, Austin, pastoring of the Dayton Stillwater SEA Church in Dayton, Ohio. Also, a daughter, Nicole, is an obstetrics and John. Miranda, their daughter, is a philanthropy writer for LLU and is a master's student in English. So it is my privilege to introduce our speaker. Just one other little piece of tidbit. His wife was recruited by one of our professors here at the university that recruited in South America. And so that was meant to be, because when she came over here, her and Randy met and they became married. So let's turn our minds and our hearts to our speaker today.
Thank you very much to Mickey. It was actually his mother-in-law who recruited my wife, Anita, to come to Keene to learn English. I wonder, Anita, would you be willing to stand? She'll forgive me later, I trust. I'm delighted to have Anita here with me today. I was a single pastor in Austin, Texas, and a friend of mine named Bill Norman, also a graduate of Keene, also single, in the Oklahoma Conference, called me and said, "You need to go meet the woman who manages Keene Travel." Now, Bill led me out on more than a few limbs that he sawed off, and so I was very suspicious. I said, "Why are you trying to get me to go meet her? You're single, you go meet her." No, she's your type. I just wasn't sure I could trust Bill. But after a number of times coming up and him, I was in Austin coming up to Keene, and him asked me after, "Did you go meet her?" "No, I didn't." He finally told me one time, "Well, don't worry about it. I introduced her," and he named another friend of ours. "He's going to go out with her." I said, "He is? Well, maybe I'll go meet her." And so I walked into the travel agency. I took one look, and I said to her, "Meet the man you're going to marry." She said, "Where is he?" I said, "I that speak unto thee am he." She said, "Lord, increase my faith." Not exactly, but along those lines. So this morning in the first service, we were asked, "If you met your spouse here at Keene, please stand." They met here at Southwestern. I wasn't sure whether to stand or not because I wasn't a Southwestern student then, but I stood. And Anita and I have been partners in life now for many years, and it's a joy to be here together. I want to say thank you in a special way to President Patterson and to her alumni team. It's a delight to be here. I also want to tell you that your pastor, Michael Gibson, in our meetings of the pastors, senior pastors of college and university churches in the North American Division, annual meetings, he's much respected and much beloved. And I think you ought to be very proud of him. And I just want to say thank you to him for this privilege as well. I also want to recognize and say thank you to the previous senior pastor, James Weingartner, who's my brother-in-law, and the rest of my family are here, Roland and Nathan and Mary Ellen Weingartner. It's truly a delight to be back here. This, in so many ways, feels like home. Although I am reminded of something Dr. Floyd Brzee, senior pastor here back when I was in school, said at an alumni gathering at Walla Walla University. He stood up and he said, "Most of you," talking to all these alumni gathered, "most of you have changed so much, you didn't even recognize me." And takes a minute. But that's how many of us feel at gatherings like this. They're wonderful gatherings, but they're also gatherings that bring us face to face with certain kinds of questions. The question today, I think, is the question, what are you doing here? Or you could ask it, I suppose, in the first person, what am I doing here? It's a question that we asked as students. We had to clarify the answer because it was a question of purpose, of vision, of mission. But now as we come back years later, some of us decades later, it's still a question. Because some, having spent many years in their work, in their business, in their ministry, maybe drawing near to the end of that career, are once again asking the question, what am I doing here? What is my purpose? What is my mission? It's a question we have to get right. When I was a kid here, I was down at KAES. I don't know how I got out of class that day. I must have sneaked out, but I sneaked out up to the old Evans Hall because I'd been told that the speaker that day at chapel was going to be a player for the Dallas Cowboys. And so I sneaked out. I went up and I stood at the back, kind of leaning on the wall back there, hoping nobody would throw me out, and I'm sure also hoping that KAES didn't find out where I was. And the player got up and he began to speak, and I listened for a little while, and then I thought, what am I doing here? I haven't really heard, I mean, I've heard his name. He's a backup. Nobody that important. What am I doing here? And so I slipped out and went back to class. Slipped out on a speaker by the name of Roger Staubach. Not one of my more shining moments of answering the question, what am I doing here? What are you doing here? It's a question that we encounter in many circumstances and many ways in life. Several weeks ago at Loma Linda, I told a story that happened here at Keene. While I was a student here at Keene, there was a story that made the rounds about a young man, supposedly at Jefferson Academy, who sneaked into the girls' dorm, and the word got to the dean, and she immediately was tromping down the hall, room to room, trying to find if he was there. She finally came to the room where she thought he might be, under the bed, behind the dresser. The girl was standing there petrified. She yanked open the closet door, and there he stood, wide-eyed, sure that his life was over. And she asked him the question, what are you doing here? He thought about it for a second, and then he said, well, everybody's got to be somewhere. Now, I told my congregation back in Loma Linda, I'm not sure that was a true story, but it was told as though it was true. A few days later, I got an email from a woman who said that story was true. It was my husband. He was kicked out, and he should have been. So there you go. What are you doing here? Well, everybody's got to be somewhere. In fact, sometimes through our college careers, it seemed like that was the way we answered the question. We're not sure about out there, but everybody's got to be somewhere. They accepted me. So here I am. What are you doing here? When I was here at Keene as a student, I had the privilege of being the student leader for the campus ministries department. And I was always looking during that time I was there for a good speaker. And somebody, a credible source, said, there's an assistant coach for the Dallas Cowboys who has a great testimony for Christ. You ought to see if he'd come and speak to us. And so I guess I was intrepid in those days. I dialed the Dallas Cowboys number, female voice answered, Dallas Cowboys. And I asked for this coach, expecting that I would have to jump through some hoops and get through some red tape before maybe I could get to his assistant. Instead, the next voice on the line was the gruff voice of Coach Mike Ditka. Coach Ditka here. Well, I didn't know what to say. I stumbled around. I explained who we were. I said, would you come? He said, I'll come. How much do you charge? That's not the big thing in my life. I'm happy to come. So he came. He came. We over at Evans Hall, we showed the highlight film from the Dallas Cowboys from the year before. I sat right beside him. He shook my hand. Huge hand, kind of like shaking a leg, huge hand. And we watched that, and then he stood up and he told stories, one of which was, he said, at training camp, we have curfew. All the players back in their rooms, and we check. He said, us coaches, we walk the hallways to make sure nobody's getting out. He was walking the hallway one night. When he came around the corner, he almost ran smack dab into a player, dressed to the nines, his shoes in his hands, tiptoeing and stocking feet toward the exit. Now, I don't know who you would not want to run into in that situation. I would not want to run into Mike Ditka. And there he stood. He looked at the player for a moment, looked him up and down, and said, what are you doing here? The question. What are you doing here? The player just stared at him, froze for a moment. And then he said, I dropped my wallet out in the parking lot. I'm just going to go get it. And Ditka said, what are you going to do? Sneak up on it? Get back in your room. What are you doing here? Well, just sneaking through here. Going to get out there where life really happens. That's what I'm excited about. What are you doing here? The question of purpose. I was listening to talk radio out in Southern California several years ago when the talk radio host said, I'm going to give a money prize, a cash prize, to the person who can give me the best reason for moving out of L.A. and tell me where it is they want to move to, the greatest vision, the greatest dream. I'm going to give them a cash prize to help them on their way. So people were calling in, and I'm driving with a friend of mine, and he and I are talking, and we're thinking, man, the beaches of Hawaii, the mountains of Colorado, we could think of all kinds of places. When a woman called in, and she said, I'm going to win this thing. He said, okay, where do you want to move? Where do you want to go? She said, I live in downtown L.A., and I have always had this grand dream of moving out of downtown L.A. Where are you going to move to? She said, I want to move to Burbank. Burbank. Now, if you don't know the geography from downtown L.A., you get on the clogged freeway called Interstate 5, and you spend about, depending on the time of day, half hour to an hour going 10 miles, and you'll be in Burbank. And the host said, Burbank, that's your dream? And he hung up on it. And I thought, some of us just have too limited of a vision. What are you doing here? Well, everybody's got to be somewhere. Just trying to sneak through this and get up to Burbank where life is really taking place. That's my answer. Well, we had to answer it as students. We have to answer it as alumni. Even though we're a few road markers later on the highway of life, the purpose question never quite goes away. Now, unfortunately, for some, there's never an answer. Somebody sent me a cartoon a little while ago, had a dozing faculty member in a faculty meeting. And underneath that cartoon, the caption said, when I die, I hope it's in a faculty meeting because the transition will be so subtle. Isn't that the truth for some, where there's classroom, faculty meeting, business, wherever you are, I'm just getting through. There's nothing that truly inspires or drives me. So we come here today with that question. What are you doing here? Whether you're a student, a faculty member, an alumni, or just a friend, it's a question for you. It's the question God asked of Elijah. Elijah, that blood and guts prophet in the Old Testament, Elijah who bursts suddenly onto the center stage of Israel's history. Many personalities in Scripture are introduced by their genealogy, by their location, by who their kids were, by what their names mean. Elijah is introduced in 1 Kings 17:1 with one word, and that's it. The verse says, now Elijah, boom, there he is, center stage. Appearing before Ahab and telling him, we're going to play a game of show and tell. You will see no rain until I say so. And then he races out to play a game of hide and seek. The country erodes around him without rain until that infamous moment when he encounters Ahab in the dry dust of Palestine at that time. And Ahab says, are you the one troubling Israel? He says, not me, but you. In fact, he says, meet me on the mountain. We're going to have a divine duel for a divided people. The God who answers by fire, that one will be God. And so it happens there. That prayer standoff, which Elijah wins, because God answers with a fiery holocaust from the sky that obliterates the altar and everything on it. It ends with the people on their faces in the dust chanting, the Lord, He is God. The Lord, He is God. And then that experience where Elijah says to King Ahab, I see that there's a cloud the size of a man's fist over the Mediterranean. Get ready and go, for I hear the sound of heavy rain. And then, as though he's some kind of superhero, he grabs the horse's bridle and outruns the king's chariot 20 miles back to Jezreel in the swirling dust and the pouring rain. What a moment. He lives his purpose on the mountaintop for God. 12 hours later, he's on the run. On the run because somebody has shaken him awake and has said to him, tomorrow you're going to be just as dead as are the prophets of Baal. And Elijah's world collapses. 40 days he runs back to Oreb, better known as Sinai, the mountain of God. 40 days later, he disappears into a cave, shuts himself all off from all outside light, from any outside contact, from any time with God, and he descends into the depression that the spoken of by the darkness that surrounds him. And it is in that moment, 1 Kings 19, as was read by Gabriel, that God comes to him and asks him the question, what are you doing here, Elijah? You see, it had been in Elijah's life that God said, and Elijah went and did. That precedes in the story. God said, Elijah went and did. This time, God didn't say, Elijah just went and did. And so now God comes to him, speaking to him in the darkness. He says, Elijah, come out of the cave. What are you doing here? And then come the cataclysmic catastrophes of nature. As he's there, he can hear the wind whistling past the entryway to the cave. He knows God can be in the wind. God was in the wind in the whirlwind with Job. But here it says, God was not in the wind, and Elijah stayed in the cave. And then the rumble and the tremor of the earth beneath his feet. What worse place to be in an earthquake than bouncing about like a ping pong ball in a cave? Elijah knew God could be in the cave. He knew he could be in the earthquake. It had been here that God had hidden Moses in a cave. It had been here that the earthquake announced God's presence. And yet the text says God wasn't in the earthquake and Elijah stayed in the cave. And then the stench, the acrid sulfuric smell of smoke stinging his nostrils. Could God be in the fire? 40 days ago, the God who answered by fire, that one was God. And yet the text says, God was not in the fire, and Elijah stayed in the cave. And then there was a stillness, an eerie calm, a dead silence. We had the privilege on more than one occasion of climbing that mountain, a mountain that many believe is likely Sinai. We got separated, some on camels, some on foot. I won't forget the experience of climbing Sinai about 1:30, 2 a.m. in the stillness of the Egyptian night, accompanied only by the moon and the awesome stillness around me. That's Elijah. And in that stillness, he hears the still small voice. And at that point, says the narrator, he wrapped his face in his mantle and came out of the cave to stand in the presence of God. 1 Kings 19, and the word of the Lord came to him. What are you doing here, Elijah? I've been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, put your prophets to death with a sword. I'm the only one left, and they're trying to kill me. The Lord said, go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by. Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake came a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire came a gentle whisper. When Elijah heard it, he pulled his cloak over his face and went out and stood at the mouth of the cave. Then a voice came to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He replied, "I've been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, put your prophets to death with the sword. I'm the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too." And the Lord said to him, "Go. Go." Elijah has lost his purpose. When God asks him, "What are you doing here?" he says, "Your people are all against you, God. In fact, God, I'm the only one you have left." And God will say to him, "Get over yourself, Elijah. I got thousands more where you came from. You're not the last, best, greatest. Come out of the cave. Because I want you to encounter me. And I want to give you an answer to the question, what are you doing?" God essentially says two things to Elijah as Elijah is shut away in the cave. The first thing he says is, "Come. Come out. Come out of the cave. Come back into the light. Come back into human contact. Come back into contact with me. Have an experience with the Almighty God who called you to begin with. Encounter me, because in that you will find life-giving purpose, life-transforming vision. Come out." That's the first thing he says. The second thing he says is, "Go. Go. Elijah, I'm not done with you. You've had peaks and valleys. You've had a mountaintop experience like no other. And when you had that mountaintop experience, you descended from the mountain only to discover that in certain senses, nothing had changed. And so you felt like a catastrophic failure. But Elijah, I'm not done with you. I have a purpose for you. I have a mission for you to complete. I have a work for you to do that will not end until you are swept from earth to glory in chariots of fire. It will not end until you are in my presence. So go." It's the same thing he says to us. Whether you're a student dozing in some classes or an aging alumni nearing the end of the road, God has a purpose for your life. And it will only come in a deep encounter with Him that you will have that renewed sense of vision to which He calls you. The man had worked for decades, extremely successful in his career. Could we read today through his CV, we would marvel at all of his accomplishments, everything he had done. But now as he came to the twilight of his career, the question was, what now? It affected him deeply enough that that caring person, a family member, took him to see a therapist. And that therapist walked into the room. He would say different things. But it's what he would say at the first that stands out. "How are you today, sir?" "Not so good." "What's going on?" "Long career. Not sure what's next. Retirement. Then." And the therapist simply said, "Sir, you never stop serving Christ. Never." whether you're a freshman, undecided major, or you're an alum for whom the years have passed so quickly, you never stop serving Christ. So if you've been in that cave, God has just a couple of words for you. Oh, he'll start by asking you, what are you doing here? He wants you to understand what it is at the core of your soul where the need exists. But then he'll say, come out of the cave, back into human contact, back into the light of my love, encounter me as I am. And now, once you've encountered me, go.
For yourself, dream your dreams, chase your heart above all else. Make a name the world remembers. But an all-empty world can sell his empty dreams. I got lost in the light when it was up to me to make a name the world remembers. But Jesus is the only name to remember. And I don't want to leave a legacy. I don't care if they remember me. Only Jesus. And I don't care if they remember me. Only Jesus.
Joined us today for our Elevate Worship Service.
And thank you to Pastor Randy Roberts, pastor of Loma Linda University Church, for being our featured speaker this morning.
Now, before you go, here are a few announcements that you need to know about this special homecoming weekend. Today, after our church services, we invite all of our alumni to join for our annual alumni potluck that's going to be taking place at the Laisky Poultar Gym at 1:30. We invite you to bring a dish to share with your friends, but if you can't, please join us anyways because all are welcome. At 2:30, we're going to be taking our annual honor class photos, so please make your way to the gymnasium to be a part of this moment in time with your classmates. This afternoon, we have all kinds of activities happening on campus, including various tours, an art exhibit, our dinosaur museum will be open. To find out information of all of our afternoon programming, please scan the QR code located on the screen.
And tonight at 8 p.m. are our class parties. We invite you to come out to our third annual tailgate party, which will be happening in the parking lot of the Laisky Poultar Gymnasium. Lots of good food, games, and a basketball game, and it's going to be fun. You don't want to miss it. Our 50th year reunion is going to be happening at the Cops Museum at 8 p.m., and also the 55-plus will be at the Keene Church Annex. And to top it all off, we're excited to share with you that at 9:30 this evening at the Duck Pond will be our fireworks show. It's going to be a blast.
Oh, yes. I cannot wait. All are welcome. Please join us for that great finale to the evening. And tomorrow morning, we hope that you join us in our student center from 8:30 to 10. We have a special fundraising opportunity for student missions, and that is a pancake breakfast at our student center. All are invited to join us. And after that, please join us at the soccer fields because we have an alumni versus student soccer match, and all are welcome to come, participate, cheer on your friends and family. We'd love to see you there.
And one last item, if you're regularly part of our worship community or will be here next week, I want to remind you on April 21st at 7 p.m. right here in the King Church Sanctuary, we're excited to have the artist Shane and Shane for a night of worship. Doors open at 6:30 and it's free admission, but seating is limited. So please come early and enjoy a wonderful night of worship together and with Shane and Shane.
And lastly, as Southwestern Adventist University celebrates 130 years, we are so excited that the legacy in our Keene community continues. Each of you are such an important part of what we do at the university, and we just want to thank you, our alumni and our community, for coming together as we celebrate our homecoming this weekend.
Just stand with us as we sing our final song this morning.
I saw Satan fall like lightning. I saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. I believe in signs and wonders. I have resurrection power. My name is registered in heaven. Oh, my praise belongs to you forever. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony, yeah. Oh, 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 yeah. Oh, come together, sons.
sons and daughters, bought with blood and washed in water. Sing the praises of the Spirit, Son and Father. Our God will finish what He started. Oh, our God will finish what He started. Oh, this is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, this is my testimony.
Amen, amen, amen.
Amen. We hope that you enjoyed this Elevate worship service. And I just want to thank Pastor Roberts once again for challenging us. What are we doing here, and where is God asking us to go?
Amen, amen. Now, as we wrap up worshiping together, we want to invite you to do something we do here at Elevate every single week, which is we say a blessing together. And the idea is just, man, that you would walk away feeling blessed and refreshed. So let's say that together out of 1 Thessalonians together. It goes like this.
May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it.
Amen. Happy Sabbath. Be blessed, friends.
Happy Sabbath.